Sūrah, Sūrat al-Aʻrāf. Sūrat al-Aʻrāf is revealed in the same time period as Sūrat al-An'am. So it's the end of Mecca. Okay? But Sūrat al-An'am and Sūrat al-Aʻrāf, they work together. And how did they work together? Sūrat al-An'am sort of establishes the warning, and it establishes the glad tidings for those who believe. And it lays out a final argument to the people of Mecca. Surah Al-A'raf, the next surah, talks about the consequences to those now that will reject. So it sort of fast forwards to the hereafter, and the regret and the remorse that people feel in the hereafter for not having listened to that guidance, not having accepted the guidance that came to them in the form of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So again, Surah Al-An'am sort of lays the premise. It's the final argument. Surah Al-A'raf talks about the consequences and the circumstances now as a result of people sort of choosing their different paths. So the believers obviously choosing to accept that guidance despite being a persecuted minority and sticking firm to that, while the oppressors and those who reject faith continuing to insist on oppressing the believers and putting them in these difficult situations. So Surah Al-A'raf is, it remains in that same breath, in that same argument. And the first 10 verses of Surah Al-A'raf, it's very powerful, speak about the regret of the people once they've been punished. So the punishment has now come to them. So Allah's talking about the punishment coming to them, and the people admitting, the wrongdoers admitting, inna lazalimun, that indeed we were amongst the oppressors, we were amongst the transgressors, we did not listen to the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us to listen to, we were not paying attention. And so the first 10 verses are nothing but the regret of the people that have insisted upon turning away from misguidance. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in verse 12 the real reason why they disbelieve, the real reason why they turned away from guidance. It wasn't because the arguments of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were not convincing to them. It wasn't because the Quran was not mind-blowing to them. It wasn't because the moral uprightness of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions was not, was not pristine. It wasn't because any of that. It was because the messenger was not their person. He was not from their tribe. It was tribalistic. It was nationalistic. It was economic. The reason why they turned away from the Prophet ﷺ was not because of the Qur'an or the Qur'an being unconvincing, right? And how do we know that? Allah mentions to us the story of Adam ﷺ and Iblis once again, the story of Adam and the Satan once again. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions particularly, قُلْ مَا مَنَعَكَ أَلَّا what is it, what is it that forbade you to do sajdah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? مَا مَنَعَكَ, what forbade you, O shaytan, O Iblis, O accursed devil, to prostrate to me, إِذْ أَمَرْتُكَ, when I commanded you to do so? What stopped you from doing sujood? قَالَ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِنْهُ خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ طِينٍ. So Iblis responds and says, I am better than him. You created me from fire and you created him from dirt. And that's exactly why the people of Mecca rejected the Prophet ﷺ, right? His outside of his tribesmen, Abu Jahl is from Banu Makhzum, right? So for Abu Jahl, I can't have a person from Banu Hashim having that upper hand on me. So it was an idea of, I'm better than him. For the people of Thaqif, they said, had this message not been revealed to one of the two people, رَجُلًا مِنَ الْقَرْيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٌ, one of the great people, of the two great towns, why did it come to him? Why the Prophet ﷺ? So it was not about the message, it was about the messenger. And to some people, of course, to Abu Lahab, it was economic. He's from Banu Hashim, but to Abu Lahab, this is a matter of economics and so on and so forth. So it was truly nationalistic, or it was tribalistic. And there were other motives why they turned away from the Prophet ﷺ. For many of them, it was because the Prophet ﷺ was not from amongst them. So we almost have a parallel in the shaytan rejecting Adam ﷺ because of the way Adam was created. And we see that with the Prophet ﷺ. So yes, the first racist in the world is shaytan. SubhanAllah, the first racist created is the devil himself. So when you are racist, you are satanic by necessity, because you're following along in that same discourse that Shaytan did and the people of Mecca, you know, adapted collectively, and as a result of that attained the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rather than the guidance. And this is where we start to see in Surah Al-A'raf the particular ways that Shaytan insists upon leading us astray. Okay, so Shaytan, you know, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for respite, to be left alone, to be, you know, to be able to live without being put in hellfire immediately, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granting him that respite, and then Shaytan saying that as you led me astray, I will lead all of them astray. لَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. Shaytan blaming Allah for leading him astray. If you realize in the first few, in the last parts of Surah Al-An'am, fading into the surah, what does Allah mention? He mentions His will. Allah mentions that He guides those who seek guidance, and He leads astray those who seek to be astray. So you cannot blame Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for your guidance or your misguidance, because Allah has given you choice. Allah has given you the ability to recognize guidance and to accept it or to reject it. So Shaytan is one of those people that's scapegoating, you know, the mashi'ah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the concept of predestination. So he blames Allah himself. Bima aghwaytani, you led me astray, O Allah. Not his arrogance, not his pride, when he refused to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam, because Adam was made from dirt while he's made from fire. No, he blames Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for leading him astray. So it's like Allah squashed the argument in the end of Surah Al-An'am, and he's now giving us the way that Satan made that argument. And he says, ثُمَّ لَآتِيَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ وَعَنْ أَيْمَانِهِمْ وَعَنْ شَمَائِلِهِمْ, that I will come to them from in front of them, from behind them, from their right, from their left. And he says that I, you know, that the end goal of my da'wah to people, the end goal of my calling people away from you, O Allah, is that وَلَا تَجِدُ أَكْثَرُهُمْ شَاكِرِينَ, you will find that the majority of them will be ungrateful people. And subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Shaytan was right, that you will find that the majority of them are not grateful people. And a manifestation of that, just a few ayat later, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Adam alayhi salam, right? And Adam alayhi salam and and Eve obviously being approached with their desire. So once again, the same concept that Shaytan rejected for pride, Adam alayhi salam turned away temporarily because of his desires. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to them, you know, why is it that you did not respond to the command of Allah not to eat from that tree? Adam and Eve, why did you still eat from that tree? And what was the thing that Shaytan came to them and said that the only reason, this is verse 20, the only reason your Lord forbade you from eating this tree is that you would become malakain, you would become angels, or أَوْتَكُونَ مِنَ الْخَالِدِينَ, or you would become immortal. So the only reason God's stopping you from this tree is because it would make you angels or it would make you immortal. So Shaytan led them astray with their desires, right? He led them temporarily astray with their desires, but he maintained permanent disobedience because of his pride. And what's the connection? Shaytan, again, the end goal of his da'wah, the end goal of his call to people is to make them ungrateful, right? If I can make them not shakirin. And this is exactly what it is. Adam and Eve had Jannah, they had everything, but that they didn't have that one tree. And we are ungrateful when we look to what we don't have as opposed to what we do have. That's the definition of ingratitude, right? We focus on the things that we don't have as opposed to the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has actually bestowed upon us. So Shaytan actually says, here's the blueprint of how I can lead the children of Adam astray. I led him astray, it worked for him, even though it was temporarily, it worked for him and it worked for Eve. It will work with his children as well, to lead them astray through ingratitude. And this is where in verse 23, we find Adam alayhi salam and Eve calling upon Allah and saying, رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ, that, oh our Lord, we have wronged ourselves, and if you don't forgive us and have mercy upon us, then we will be from the ultimate losers. This is actually, this dua is the tafsir, it is the explanation of the words that Allah mentions in Surah Al-Baqarah. فَتَلَقَى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ, that Adam alayhi salam was inspired with some words of repentance from Allah, This is the tafsir. These are the words that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired Adam and Eve with to come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah mentions in verse 27, Ya bani Adam, O children of Adam, لا يفتننكم الشيطان. Don't let the shaitan test you or put you to trial. كما أخرج أبويكم من الجنة. The way that he led your parents out of Jannah. Don't let the shaitan do the same thing with you that he did with them. So maintain, maintain that gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and maintain that pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by coming back to Him. So when you're temporarily led astray, always come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so beautifully, Allah mentions the believers when they enter into paradise. Shaytan blamed Allah for his misguidance. Allah mentions the believers entering into paradise, and they say, Alhamdulillahi alladhi hadana lihada wama kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah. They're in paradise, and they're saying, all praises be to Allah who guided us to this, and we certainly, wama kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah, we would not have been able to find guidance had it not been for the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they're thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for their guidance and for the things that Allah has bestowed upon them. And this is a beautiful manifestation of the attitude of the believer. And he doesn't blame the will of God, right? He thanks Allah for having willed that he be guided. Right? He doesn't blame the will of God for misguidance or his shortcomings. He thanks Allah for having guided him to goodness. And this juz ends off with the conversations between the people of Jannah and the people of hellfire. So the people of hellfire are now seeing the consequences. The people of Jannah are now seeing the reward. And the people of hellfire asking the people of paradise for water. They're asking the people of paradise for respite and relief. But the fact of the matter is that at that point it's too late, right? So Allah gave you the warning in Surah Al-An'am, and Allah gives you the consequences and the reward in Surah Al-A'raf. And so you have the conversations between the people of Jannah and the people of hellfire. And then some of the stories of the prophets, particularly that warned their people in Nuh, in Shu'aib, in Salih, in Lut, in Musa. May Allah send His peace and blessings upon them all. They warned their people about being punished, but they still turned away. So Allah mentions to us the manifestation of that punishment while mentioning to us the manifestation of the reward of those who held firm. So again, that's Juz 8. And Juz 8 goes all the way up to... let me see the exact verse number for you guys. Juz 8 goes all the way up to... I lost the verse number. All the way up to verse 87 of Surah Al-A'raf. So, inshallah ta'ala, here's what we're going to do. I know a lot of you guys are tuned in live. And some of you are probably trying to catch up. I'm going to give a 10-minute break, inshallah ta'ala. And then I'm going to start a new live stream in 10 minutes, inshallah ta'ala, where I'll go ahead and I'll do Juz 9 so that we can catch up. So I apologize again for not having been able to do yesterday, but inshallah ta'ala, hopefully we can catch up today, and hopefully you guys are finding this meaningful. So please do, inshallah ta'ala, continue to study and make dua and pay attention. So I'll give you guys a 10-minute break, get your notes in order, inshallah ta'ala, and get caught up, and then we'll go ahead and we'll start with the 9th Juz. Jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.